Please let these words serve as a guide to us, the black race, as was and is intended, because the struggles continues. Brethren and sistren, I present to you all a collection of speeches from one of Earth's greatest prophet, leader, philosopher, elder statesman, black nationalist, and the founding father of Pan-Africanism, the Right Honorable Marcus Mazaya Garvey.
Chatham did it.
America under George Washington did it. Africa with 400 million black people can do it. If you cannot do it, if you are not prepared to do it, then you will die. You raise a coward, you raise a imbeciles, you raise a good for nothing. If you cannot do what other men have done, what other nations have done, what other races have done, then you have better die. Christ to despise. We appeal to you for help, for succor, for leadership. When you endeavor to carry your burden up the heights of Calvary, when white men spurned you, when white men scorned you, when white men spat upon you, when white men pierced your side out of which blood and water gushed forth, it was a black man in the name of Simon the Syrian who took your cross and bore it up the heights of Calvary. And now that we are bearing our burden of being so heavy, we just ask that you just help us all up the heights. Oh, yes, the cause is grand, the cause is glory. Surely we shall not turn back. Oh, sail on, sail on, sail on, oh, mighty ship of state, sail on. Sail on until the flag of the red, the black, and the green is perched upon the hills of South Africa. Because the time has come for the black man to forget his hero worship of other races and to create and emulate heroes of his own. We must canonize our own saints, create our own martyrs, and elevate the positions of fame and honor, black men and women who have made a distinct contribution to our racial history. Sojourner Truth is worthy of a place of sainthood alongside of Joan of Arc. Christopher Addison and George William Gordon are entitled to the halo of martyrdom with no less glory than the martyrs of any other race. Toussaint Louverture's brilliancy as a soldier or a statesman outshone that of any other people. Hence he's entitled to the highest place as a hero among men. Because Africa's created millions and countless millions of black men and women in war and peace, whose luster and bravery outshone that of even any other people. So why not see good and perfection in ourselves? We must inspire our literature and promulgate a doctrine of our own without any apologies to the powers that be. That right is ours and God. Let sentiments and cross opinions go to the winds. We are entitled to our own opinions and are not obligated to or bound by the opinions of others. If others laugh at you, return the laughter to them. If they mimic you, return the compliment with equal force. Because they have have no more right to dishonor, discredit you in manhood that you have in dealing with them. Honor them when they honor you. Disrespect and disregard them when they vilely treat you. Their arrogance is but skin deep, an assumption that has no foundation in morals or in law. They have sprung from the same family tree of obscurity as we have. Their history is as rude in its primitiveness as ours. Their ancestors were running wild and living in trees of branches like monkeys as ours. They made human sacrifices, ate the flesh of their own dead and wild meat from beasts for centuries, even as they have accused us of doing. Their cannibalism is more prolonged than ours. When we were embracing the banks of the Nile, they were still drinking blood out of the skulls of their conquered dead. After our civilization had reached the noonday of progress, they were still living in holes with bats, rats, and other insects and animals. After we had already unfathomed the mystery of the stars and reduced the heavenly constellation to minute and regular calculus, they were still backwoodsmen living in ignorance and in blatant darkness. Indebted to us for the benefits of civilization. They stole our arts and sciences from Africa. Then why should we be ashamed of ourselves? Their modern improvement to be reflected and resurrected by our generation and our posterity. Why should we be discouraged if somebody laughs at us today? Who's to tell what tomorrow will bring forth? Did they not laugh at Christ, Moses, Muhammad? Was there not a Carthage, Greece, and Rome? So we see and have changes every day. So pray, work, be steadfast, and be not dismayed. Because as the Jew is held together by his religion, the white race is by the assumption and the unwritten law of superiority, the Mongolian by the precious tie of blood, likewise the black man must unite in one grand racial hierarchy. Our union must know no clime, no nationality, but let us all hold together in every country, in every clime, making a racial empire upon which the sun shall never set. But your own speak to you from the depths. Let no influence but your own rouse you in time of peace and time of war. Hear all, but attend only to that which concerns you. Your allegiance shall be to your God, your race, your country. Remember that the Jew in his political and economic origin is always first the Jew. The white man is first a white man under all circumstances, so you can do no less. Be black, buy black, think black, and all else will take care of itself. Let no one inoculate you with evil doctrines to suit his own conveniences. Charity begins at home. So first to thyself be true, and thou canst not then be false for no man. Because God and nature first made us what we are. And out of our own creative genius, we make ourselves what we want to be. Follow always that great law. Let God and the sky be our limit and eternity our measurement. There is no height to which you cannot climb without the active intelligence of your own mind. Mind creates, and as much as we desire in nature, we can have through the creation of our own minds. And today, being scientifically the weaker race, you shall treat others only as they treat you. But in your homes and everywhere possible, you must teach the higher development of science to your children. And make sure that we have a race of scientists par excellence. For in religion and science lies our only hope to withstand the evil designs of modern materialism. Never forget your God. Remember that we live, work, and pray for a binding racial hierarchy, whose only natural, spiritual, and political limits shall be God and Africa at home and abroad.
People of the world into one vast organization to plant the banner of freedom on the great continent of Africa. If Europe is for Europeans, then Africa is for the black peoples of the world. Men and women as black as I am, and even more so, had believed themselves white under West Indian order of society. I was simply an impossible man to use openly the term Negro, yet everyone beneath his breath was calling the black man a nigger. I had to decide whether to please my friends and be one of the black whites of Jamaica and be reasonably prosperous, or come out openly and help improve and protect the integrity of the black millions and suffer. I decided to do the latter.
There is no future for a people who deny their past. My forebearers, my grandparents, my mother and father did not suffer and die to give me an education to oppress, slight, or discourage my people. Whatsoever education I acquired out of their sacrifice of over 300 years, I shall use for the salvation of the 400 million Negroes of the world. And the day when I forsake my people, may God Almighty say there shall be no more light for you. I unequivocally rejected the racist assumptions of much white American Christianity, namely that God had created the black man inferior and that he had intended Negroes to be a servant class. He was of wood and drawers of water. I predicated my view of man and the doctrine of Imago Dei. All men, regardless of color, were created in the image of God. From this premise followed the equality of all men and also the brotherhood of all men. The biblical injunction of Acts 17:26 reminds us that he created of one blood all nations of men to dwell on the face of the earth. I was most interested in brotherhood within his own race. If Negroes are created in God's image and Negroes are black, then God must in some sense be black. If the white man has the idea of a white God, let him worship his God as he desires. We have found a new ideal. Whilst our God has no color, yet it is human to see everything through one's own spectacles. And since the white people have seen their God through white spectacles, we have only now started out to see our God through our own spectacles. We believe in the God of Ethiopia, the everlasting God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, the one God of all ages. That's the God in whom we believe. We shall worship him through the spectacles of Ethiopia. Do you know what it means to be a man? To be a man is to bear resemblance of the Creator, the image of the Creator. If you are conscious of the fact that you are created in the image of the Creator, then you are a man. Man is a religious being, that is to say, he must have some kind of belief, call it superstition or not. Man who has started to think traces his origin beyond man, and such has been groping in the dark to find out the source from whence he came, and by our own intuition, we have attributed that source to something beyond us, and in so believing, we accept the idea of a religion. Some make our God a God of fire, some make our God a God of water, some make our God a God of elements, and others of us accept the Christian belief. Man's religion is something we cannot eliminate from his system or destroy in him. Therefore, it is folly for any man to go about attacking another man's religion because to him it is fundamental. You may be a Christian, you may be a Mohammedan, that is your religion. We are all entitled to our religious beliefs. Some of us are Catholic, some of us are Presbyterian, some of us are Baptists, and we deem it a right to adhere to our particular belief. The white world has always tried to rob and discredit us of our history. They tell us that Tutankhamun, the king of Egypt, who reigned about the year 1350 BC, was not a black man, that the ancient civilization of Egypt and the pharaohs was not of our race. But that does not make the truth unreal. Every student of history of impartial mind knows that we once ruled the world. When white men were savages and barbarians living in caves, that thousands of Negro professionals at that time taught in the universities of Alexandria, then the seat of learning. No black man shall be truly respected until the race as a whole has emancipated itself through self-achievement and progress from universal prejudice. The black man will have to build his own government, industry, art, science, literature, and culture before the world will stop to consider him. Until then, we are but wards of a superior race and civilization and the outcasts of a standard social system. One of our problems historically is that we have always been reacting to initiatives taken by other people. To fight for African redemption does not mean that we must give up our domestic rights. It does not mean that we must become disloyal to any government or to any country wherein we were born. We can be as loyal American citizens or British subjects as the Irishman or the Jew, and yet fight for the redemption of Africa and complete emancipation of the race. We believe in the United States Constitution for the Americans, but we stand for the idea of Africa for the Africans. It is not our intention, our purpose, to send all black people back to Africa. No. Those of us who go to Africa will become pioneers, pilgrim fathers of the new nation. It is the decision of the black man to make Africa a nation to which we can look for help and support, moral and physical, when ill-treated or abused for being black people. A strong man is strong everywhere. The first black heavyweight boxing champion of the world was Jack Johnson. He was a strong man, and he was strong everywhere he went. He had beaten his white opponents in Australia, he had beaten them in the United States, and he can beat them wherever they presented themselves. The African race could be like Jack Johnson. If it became strong in Africa, then it could be strong everywhere. For 250 years, we have struggled under the burden and rigors of slavery. We were brutalized, we were maimed, we were killed, we were ravaged in every way. We are men, we have souls, we have passions, we have feelings, we have hopes, we have desires like any other race. The cries raised all over the world of Canada for the Canadians, of America for the Americans, of England for the English, of France for the French, of Germany for the Germans. Do you think it unreasonable that we, the blacks of the world, should raise a cry of Africa for the Africans? The Negro is a man. We represent the new Negro. His back is not yet to the wall. We do not want his back to the wall because that would be a peculiar and desperate position. We do not want him there. It is because of this that we are asking for a fair compromise. The Belgians have control of the Belgian Congo, which they cannot use. They have not the resources to develop nor the intelligence. The French have more territory than they can develop. There are certain parts of Africa in which you cannot live at all. Now it is for you to come together and give us a United States of Africa. We are not going to be a race without a country. God never intended it, and we are not going to abuse God's confidence in us as men. We are men, human beings, capable of the same acts as any other race, possessing under fair circumstances the same intelligence as any other race. Africa has been sleeping, not dead, only sleeping. Today, Africa is walking around not only on its feet, but on its brains. You can enslave, as it was done for 300 years, the bodies of men. You can shackle the hands of men. You can shackle the feet of men. You can imprison the bodies of men, but you cannot shackle or imprison the minds of men. Dive down, black men, and dig. Reach up, black men and women, and pull all nature's knowledge to you. Turn ye around and make a conquest of everything, north and south, east and west, and then when you have wrought well, you will have merited God's blessing, you will have become God's chosen people, and naturally you will become leaders of the world. And as you bow down to the white man today, so will other races bow down to you and call you a race of masters because of the superiority of your minds and your achievements. No race has the last word on culture and on civilization. You do not know what a black man is capable of. You do not know what he is thinking. You are thinking in terms of battleships, of dreadnoughts, of submarines, of aeroplanes. Do you know what we are thinking about? That is our own private business. So give us credit for being able to use our minds. And if people becoming conscious of themselves, determined to use their minds, you do not know to what extent they can go. Liberate the minds of men, and ultimately you will liberate the bodies of men. Do you know that the black man is thinking in terms of perpetual motion? He's also thinking in terms of the hidden mysteries of the world, and you do not know what the oppressed and depressed by virtue of his condition and circumstance may give to the world as a surprise. You know that when men are forced to do things, they do them with greater effect than when they're not forced to do them. Are you going to force us into a corner where we have to think and think evil? For God's sake, do not force 280 million black men to think evil as to be a menace to the world. Do not force us to think that way. Give us a chance to live in ease as you are living, so that we can bring out those latent hidden powers which made a Newton, give us a Huxley and a Darwin. We are capable of giving such men to the world if forced into a corner to think. We are a peace-loving people. We love humanity. We love the white race, not for social fellowship, but in the common brotherhood that God intended we should live. What satisfaction can anyone get in being happy and see his brother wallowing in dirt, filth, and disease? How can men feel happy living in luxuries when others are living in disease? And then when someone tries to help the other out of the disease, the subtle culprit talks about disloyalty. My greatest desire is to see all humanity happy, whether white, yellow, or black, because I know God made this wonderful world for all mankind. The black men of Carthage, the black men of Ethiopia, the black men of Egypt, of Timbuktu and Alexandria, gave the light of civilization to the world. Ethiopia shall stretch forth her hands unto God, and princes shall come out of Egypt. Any leadership that teaches you to depend upon another race is a leadership that will enslave you. The race that leads another is always a race of masters, and the race that is led will always remain a race of slaves. They have given leadership to our foreparents, and that leadership made them slaves. We have decided to find the leadership of our own to make ourselves free men. The great scholars, after passing through our schools, their colleges, their universities, have thrown away the blessed record. Babylon did it, Assyria did it, France under Napoleon did it, Germany under Prince von Bismarck did it, Great Britain under William Pitt, Earl of Chatham did it, America under George Washington did it, Africa with 400 million black people can do it. If you cannot do it, if you are not prepared to do it, then you will die. You race of cowards, you race of imbeciles, you race of good-for-nothings. If you cannot do what other men have done, what other races have done, what other nations have done, then you had better die. Can we do it? We can do it. We shall do it. We have prayed to God for the vision and for leadership. And he himself is now our leader, and he has given us a universal vision. A vision that will not limit our possibilities to America. A vision that will not limit our possibilities to the West Indies. But a vision that says there must be a free and redeemed Africa. If we must solve this American problem, if we must solve the West Indian problem, we shall solve it only for the glory of a great empire. We shall solve it only for the glory of a great dominion, a great republic upon which the sun will never set. Whatsoever man has done, man must do. And methinks, looking into your eyes, I see great warriors rising up in the cause of African freedom. Methinks I see in the eyes of some of you men, a Brutus, reading in his tent at Philippi, a Richard Coeur de Leon bearing down on the galleons of Spain, a Napoleon storming the bridge of Lodi. Yea, men, looking into your eyes, methinks I see a crowned prince storming the forts at Verdun. Yea, more a Marshal Joffrey marching before the French artillery to win at the Marne, everlasting glory for France. And in the eyes of some of you women, I see a Florence Nightingale rising up to do service, not in the Crimean battlefield, but the battlefields of Africa, leading the hundreds and thousands of Black Cross nurses, following the millions of African legions who shall march out to do battle for the everlasting glory of Africa. I see a Joan of Arc, not the white woman of France, but a black woman of Africa, snatch at the flag of the red, the black, and the green, and say to 400 black men, follow me. Shall we make it? By the almighty and the eternal heavens, we have pledged to make it. Give us the standard bearer of Christ, let him lead, and we will follow. Christ the crucified, Christ the despised, we appeal to you from the great memories of the past. We appeal to you for help, for succor, and for leadership. When you endeavor to carry a burden up the heights of Calvary, When white men scorned you, when white men spurned you, when white men spat upon you, when white men pierced your side out of which blood and water gushed forth, it was a black man in the name of Simon the Syrian who took the cross and bore it on the heights of Calvary. So now, when we are climbing our Calvary, the burden being heavy, we ask that you help us on up the journey up the heights. Surely we shall not turn back. The cause is grand. The cause is glorious. Sail on, sail on, O mighty ship of state, sail on. We shall not stop now. We shall sail on until the red, the black, and the green is perched upon the hilltops of Africa. Classes, nations, and races which have been quite quiet for over four centuries, and who has been the hewer of wood and drawers of water for other men, who has merely borne abuse, insult, and humiliation for many generations, whose patience, docility, and forbearance can only be compared to the prophet Job, has likewise lifted his bowed head and raised it up to God's skies and cried out, I am a man, and demand a man's chance and a man's treatment in the world. Black people had always been oppressed because of our race. We should therefore strive to put our own racial self-interest first in everything we do. We should support our own businessmen, professionals, writers, athletes, and so on, provided that these persons also have their people's interest at heart. Black people should see beauty in their own kind and not try to bleach their skins or otherwise look like what we're not. In the days of slavery, miscegenation, or race mixture had occurred because the African woman had no protection from the slave master. So there is now no need for black people to themselves freely continue a practice that smacks so much of slavery. Our critics say that the race problem will be solved through higher education, through better education, that black and white will come together. That day will never come until Africa is redeemed. If those who like W.E.B. Du Bois believe that the race problem can be solved in America through higher education, they will work between now and eternity and never see the problem solved. God made man lord of his creation, gave him ownership and possession of the world, and you have been so darned lazy that you have allowed the other fellow to run away with the whole world, and now he's bluffing you and letting you know that the world belongs to him and that you have no part in it. I do not have to apologize to anybody for being black, because God Almighty knew what he was doing when he made me black. If black people knew their glorious past, then they would be more inclined to respect themselves. I shall teach a black man to see beauty in himself and be hanged to the man who said shall not be so. You've heard of Johnny Walker. Well, he had his adversities and he's still going strong, but I intend with your assistance and God's grace to continue. And my work has just begun. And when the history of my suffering is complete, then future generations will have in their hands a guide by which they shall know the sins of the 20th century. I know, and I know you too believe in time, but we shall wait patiently for 200 years, if need be, to face our enemies through our posterity. After my enemies are satisfied, in life or death I shall come back to serve, even as I've served before. In life I shall be the same, in death I shall be a terror to the foes of African liberty. If death has power, then count on me in death to be the real Marcus Garvey I would like to be. If I may come in an earthquake or a cyclone or plague or pestilence or as God would have me, then be assured that I shall never desert you and make your enemies triumph over you. Will I not go to hell a million times for you? If I die in Atlanta, my work shall not only then begin, but I shall live in the physical or the spiritual to see the day of Africa's glory. When I am dead, wrap the mantle of the red, the black, and the green around me, for in the new life I shall rise with God's grace and blessing to lead the millions up the heights of triumph with the colors that you well know. Look for me in the world when there are storms. Look for me all around you, for with God's grace I shall come and bring with me countless millions of black slaves who have died in America and the West Indies and the millions in Africa to aid you in the fight for liberty, freedom, and life. The civilization today has gone drunk and crazy with its power, and by such it seeks to injustice, fraud, and lies to crush the unfortunate. But if I'm apparently crushed by the system of influence and misdirected power, my cause shall rise again to plague the conscience of the corrupt. For this I'm satisfied, and for you I repeat, I'm glad to suffer and even die. Again I say, cheer up, for better days are ahead. I shall write the history that will inspire the millions that are coming and leave the posterity of our enemies to reckon with the hosts for the deeds of their fathers. The black race is one of the branches of the human race. As a section of humanity, he occupies a position in a world at the present time most unfavorable and most uncomfortable. The black people are subjects of ostracism. It is sad that our humanity has shown us no more love, no greater sympathy than we are experiencing. Wheresoever you go throughout the world, the black man is discarded, is ostracized, is relegated to the lowest in things, social, economic, and political. This therefore suggests a problem and one that must be solved. We in this section of the world are not entirely free from this unkind, unsympathetic, and uncharitable behavior of the groups or races around us. But since man has been placed on his own responsibility, whether he be black, we in this section of the world are not entirely free from this unkind, unsympathetic, and uncharitable behavior of the groups or races around us. But since man has been placed on his own responsibility, whether he be black, white, or yellow, he must act on his own account. We will not unduly whine or complain, but reason among ourselves and see what can be done to remedy this state of affairs. I select this subject so I may be able to reach out and touch your hearts and minds, so that we may, with better understanding, go forward and fight properly and surely the battle of life. Life is a conflict. You have to fight your way through it, whether you will it or not. Those who are able to fight most stubbornly live, accomplish most, and to them go the laurels, the palms and triumph of our civilization and world. We unfortunately have not been trained nor educated to the truths of life, paradoxically so. May I say something? To give you a true knowledge of yourself and life, so that the same glory and success attained by other men who understand themselves may be yours. Man, in the full knowledge of himself, is a superb and supreme creature of creation. When man becomes possessor of the knowledge of himself, he becomes master of his environment, the captain of his own ship, the director of his own destiny, the accomplisher of his own ends. Man should understand himself because man is full of knowledge, and this knowledge is a gift of nature. When Mother Nature created man, she deprived him of nothing. He was given the faculty of understanding all things around him, and this faculty for understanding has not been taken away from man. None of his senses have been taken away from him. So there is no excuse for the black man in lacking the knowledge that man has used to beautify the world and produce all that he needs for his happiness and civilization. Look the world over, and whatever you see in it that is pleasing to man, contributing to man's comfort, to his needs, and to his satisfaction, it is but the work of man. Man blessed with the knowledge of himself and the understanding of all things around him. If you are to live with the knowledge of yourself and with the greater knowledge of nature, you must know what is good and what is not. You must know what is finite. You must know that which is material, physical, or otherwise, is at your disposal to create or otherwise use. Yet what have we done in years gone by? There are very few things that we can place our accomplishment for the past years. At the services of the white race, the bishops of the counties and shires of England will be compelled to discourse upon the grand achievements of the Anglo-Saxon. They will tell you of the flight of the mighty aeroplane R-101 to India, which, although unsuccessful, was a new conquest of the white man in engineering. They will tell you of the conquests in art, industry, in literature. New books have been written, new editions have been made to literature by the Englishman. In the great cathedral of Notre Dame in France, the bishop lecturing to Frenchmen will tell them of the wonderful achievements of the Frenchmen. They will tell you that they have crossed the channel with greater speed than they did previously. They will tell you that they have flown from France to England in shorter time than ever before. If we leave the European countries and go to America, whether it be in the Holy Cross Cathedral in Washington or any of the great cathedrals of New York, the bishops are telling of the wonderful works the American geniuses have accomplished. If you leave America and go over to the East, to Japan, they will be telling their fellow citizens of Japan of the wonderful accomplishments of the Japanese people, proving that man is moving onward as time moves on. But you, what can I tell you? I can only point you to yourselves as disorganized. You have shown malice, prejudice, and hate to each other, and the result is that while other races have made progress, while India has made progress towards nationalism, while Ireland has made progress towards republicanism, while the whole world has made progress in man's accomplishments, you still stand fighting yourselves, dishonoring yourselves, showing no disposition toward a higher life, so that you will be abundantly best. I do hope that you will so reflect and think that you were created for some purpose other than exhibiting malice towards your neighbor or fellow men of your own race. What a pity it is that we cannot stand united without a written law, as other races do. There is no written law compelling the members of other races to stand together. They are brought together by the gentle touch of nature. The unwritten law of nature caused them to stand together on all occasions. So whether you find them in the field, industrial or political, that one touch of gentle nature causes them to stand together, if need be, die together. But with the black race, you can preach from pulpits, you lecture from the platforms, from the byways and the hedges, the spirit of cooperation, but he will not cooperate. You talk to him gently, you talk to him roughly, and still he will not cooperate. The result is that he falls prey to those who are united without a written law, but by the touch of nature, those who possess an understanding of themselves and walk through the world making you their serfs and slaves. You must acquire an understanding of yourselves. Look around you, see the smiling pictures of nature, the beautiful hedges, the wonderful mountains, the wonderful vegetation all around, the wonderful climate, the beautiful sunset, the salubrious breezes, probably not to be duplicated in any part of the world. But because of your disposition to each other, you live in suffering, in want, in penury, and in debt. You lack the gentle touch of nature, love for each other. You hate yourselves. We in this part of the world constitute 1 millionth part of 400 million, and there are not 10 of us united in the real spirit of racial love. As I have said before, a congregation of white men gathered together as you are, if you were to take a true analysis of their souls, you would find that the heart of every man present beats in unison, carrying out a certain object for the protection of himself and his posterity. But with you, it is merely different. That is your disposition. Where are we going to end? I cannot tell. It seems peculiar that we have sprung from the same mold and yet be so different. Our lack of success is traceable to our bad conduct. At the present time, there is great agitation in the country about aliens coming here and monopolizing our trade. How can we blame them when they form such a small part of our population and cannot control themselves? If there is any blame, it is yours because of the lack of cooperation among you. For they could have achieved no success if we didn't want them to. The success we should have, we deny ourselves and give it to them because we hate ourselves. Black men, black women, what is wrong with you? Why have you no affection for yourselves? Could I hope to see you living among yourselves as the people I have spoken of, living in charity, love, in sympathy with each other? It can be done. I wonder if you will adapt that course. Isn't it easier to enjoy prosperity than to live in ignorance and darkness? Why select the worst out of nature? Nature never gave pain, suffering, and death to the world. It was man himself who selected death, pain, and sorrow. I wonder if I cannot inspire you to select between good and evil, the enjoyment of which nature is...